Soweto, one-time apartheid ghetto, created to serve the labor requirements of the city of gold. Today, home to a vibrant community of some 4 million people. Every morning, some 5,000 minibus taxis, buses and trains ferry commuters to the commercial and residential suburbs of Johannesburg. In every way, it's a long road to Sandton from Soweto, 1.5 hours in peak time traffic. Like her neighbors, Angie Baloyi leaves home at 6 a.m. A legal secretary, she works in Sandton, returning in the evenings around 6:45. Not without aspiration, like many township dwellers, Angie contemplates the possibilities of a lifestyle in the suburbs.
One day, yeah, if I have enough income to provide myself, I would love to go and live in a suburb area somewhere. It's a trend thing, you know, when you start growing up, you want to go out and have your own space. And, you know, you leave your parents at home, you just come here and visit. I think that's all. I would love to move there because it's nice and quiet. Everyone is minding his or her own business. But at the same time, I don't like too much quietness. You know, I'm used to growing up, greeting my neighbor, you know, or going and having, when I just stand in the gate there, you know, I could see someone that I know and say hi and we begin chatting, you know. I'm the breadwinner at home, actually, yeah, for both my mother and my sister. And I have a son too. And I would love to move there, but it's quite expensive in there, so I don't think I'd afford it now. Maybe after 5 years, I think, yeah.
Elijah and Valerie Nkosi were both born and bred in Soweto. Elijah studied medicine, Valerie nursing. Married, they moved to Douglasdale, in the far northern suburbs of Johannesburg in 1992. In 1996, they bought this panhandle in Bryanston, where they designed and had built their dream home. 2 years later, their home complete, they moved in and have lived here ever since, with their two daughters, Cindy 9, and Bushle 8, and their 3-year-old son, Muzi. Ruth Gumbi has worked as their domestic worker for 5 years. Every morning around the breakfast table, it's final adjustments to hair and uniforms as the family tackles the daily crossword. It's the start of just another day in the suburbs, a far cry from the township.
Why most people move out of the townships? It's because of the infrastructure. The development in the township, to a very large extent, has not kept up with developments of individuals within the township. Many people leave the township because of access to resources. Access in terms of schooling for your kids, which is what we all aspire for, I mean, to get the best for our children. The resources are still skewed to previously developed areas, where there's access to various resources, but then access in the township is extremely limited.
I think it was a natural process, you know. By that time, you could buy anywhere, you know. So if you can afford to, then you do. I'm sure most people would like to move out of the township if they can, you know, but it's a little difficult if you can't afford to.
If one were to look at the crime situation, it's more of a social class at this point in time. I mean, in that if you have, you then become a target of people who are in a hopeless situation in townships, and you then be attacked. I know a few friends who've stayed on, but they've had some of those incidences. So it's more of a situation where the haves now need to try and defend what they have against people who don't have anything. It's the reality of what we're facing now, which is quite unfortunate. Around here, I've had break-ins, and mostly occurring at night, where people will come in, grab and dash if the alarm is on. If it's not on, they will then spend more time. It's that kind of a situation. That used to happen about 3-4 years ago, until I realized that almost every household around me has an electric fence. My property was the only one which didn't have an electric fence. So what I then did, after installing the electric fence, I haven't had any burglaries. And secondly, I've got an alarm that we switch on. So I suppose those are some of the basic security measures that everybody or most people around here have put in place.
In terms of feeling safe, it's actually different here because criminals think that there's more to get here probably than in Soweto. It's basically probably even more unsafe here because of that, you know, criminals wanting to come and get something. You never know what will happen, you know, when your house is broken into, especially at night when you're sleeping. People just want to take whatever they want to take. You never know what they will do to you if you are there. But then you have to go through the motions and the alarms, the electric fences. And I mean, you can see we have two gates. So it feels a little safer, but it depends on how you do your security systems. That's what makes you feel safe.
Yes, I feel far much more secure in the suburbs than in the township. But having said that, it's more of a relative term. I mean, that feeling of security. Most of the friends I have and who I spend most of my time with, it's people I grew up with in the township. Who've moved to this area. And secondly, Valerie's got three of her cousins who are staying around this area.
No, I haven't made friends around here at all. Our friends are friends we've had for a long, long time. Most of them are people Elijah grew up with, you know, and people we met while we were working, you know. It's all people from our past, I would say that, you know. So we haven't really made friends with people around here.
At age 30, Brian Mdluli has done well. He's the export manager, Africa region, for the largest roofing products company in the country. Married to his childhood sweetheart, Lindy, every morning on his way to work, Brian takes their 8-year-old son, Linda, to school at the nearby suburban preparatory school. Born and bred in Soweto, Brian has his own particular reasons for having moved out of the townships.
First of all, because I could. That's not the first reason, because I could. You know, I was allowed to do it. I could afford to do it. I wanted to be closer to work. And it was the cool thing to do. The one thing that I appreciate about the place is the privacy. I'm a very private person, and I like my space. In Soweto, there's always this thing when somebody drives by and sees your car, quickly reverses and comes in and says, "Hey, we're just passing by, man. How are you doing?" And at that time, I wanted to be alone. The quality of life, yes, look, it's better. All my shopping malls are within 5-minute driving distance. You know, better schools within the area and those kind of things. We can walk down and go play tennis with Linda. We can quickly go to the movies just up the road, yeah. Is that a better life? I don't know, but it's basically more opportunities and more exposure to worldly things, if I can put it that.
Brian is quite clear about exploiting advantages offered by the suburbs environment to full advantage for Linda. Like other New Age fathers today, he arranges his packed schedule to personally put in maximum quality time with his son. Just as his township parents did for him what was possible within their disadvantaged means, Brian wants to ensure that his achievements secure for Linda a better start in life.
I try to provide for him a whole lot more than what I received. My parents did a good job. I mean, really, they gave me everything I could have ever possibly needed in life. And I tend to take that and just pass it over to Linda. He gets more opportunities. He gets to do a little bit more than I did. Is he becoming a little bit softer and maybe not a township kid? Well, that's how I like it. He's my boy. I expose him to a whole lot more, to music, to karate, to cricket, to tennis, to maybe am I bombarding him with too much? I don't think so. All I'm saying is that he has the opportunities. Choose the ones that you want to run with and run with it.
Having sold her house in Pimville, Soweto, after house hunting for almost a year, Sibongile Mazibuko bought her new home in the quiet and affordable suburb of Sydenham earlier this year, just two blocks away from her younger sister. A BSc graduate from the University of Swaziland, Sibongile has worked for an international cosmetics house for 13 years and is currently their training and development manager. She too had particular reasons for moving out of Soweto.
It was convenience. Traffic in the morning is an absolute nightmare. So I just found that I was spending a lot of time on the road and I was becoming very aggressive. I'd get to work and I'd be tired because I'd spent so much time on the road, but also fighting with people, you know. I needed to move closer to work and it was just beginning to stress me. And I was getting to a point where I thought I'd probably get a heart attack one of the days in the traffic.
For Sibongile, a single parent, a major issue was also the investment of capital in the property market. In the township, property has little or no investment value, and as such, does not appreciate as an asset. In the suburbs, buying a house is automatically a capital investment. Taking into account her teenage son Musa, for Sibongile, this was an important consideration.
The value of my house and, you know, the value of the property, I've got some sort of security, financial security for my son.
I guess in a sense it's much better because it's closer to the entertainment and there's more things to do, I guess, more facilities and whatnot.
It's different in that you almost are isolated. I've been here for close to 2 months and I still don't know who my neighbors are. I see them when I drive in or drive out, but that's as far as it goes. Whereas, you know, in Soweto it's different. I remember when a neighbor of ours moved in, we actually took cake, which is probably a white thing, but we did that and we had tea and introduced ourselves. So I think in the township people are more, you know, they are warm and they'll try and get close to you. And in the suburbs you find that nobody really cares for anybody else.
It's just ridiculous. Why can't you just, like, you know, just be friendly and just, why can't they introduce themselves to us and welcome us into the neighborhood? It's something that I'll never understand. It's going to take a long time for us to, like, really get along and be open.
Alone in this newfound isolation, secured with all the trappings of electric gate, barred windows and doors with alarms, a seeming prerequisite to residing in the suburbs. How do Sibongile and Musa feel about their safety and security in their new environment?
Fairly safe, but I feel there's a couple of more things that I could do to make sure that I feel even more comfortable. Like an electric fence. I've thought about that. I mean, there's an alarm system, there's a burglar system, so it is okay. But you just feel, you know, you need to secure yourself more. You know, I suppose short of taking the walls even higher. But yeah, there's just a sense, this feeling that you need to make sure that you're safer.
Let's take, for example, in the township, perhaps there isn't as much security, such as the high walls we hide behind and the electric fences and whatnot. But in the township, everybody looks out for each other. I mean, everybody's friends, everybody gets along with each other. And, well, you won't get in trouble as long as you know the right people in the township.
I haven't made any new friends. The only friends that I have, I suppose, white friends, are friends at work. Besides that, the only other friends, well, there's no friends, it's just my family, my sister and my older sister, and other people from Soweto who will come in and visit. So I haven't made new friends in the area. No, not yet. Depends, I make friends easily. So if the opportunity presents itself and I see a friendly face and someone's game for a friendship, yeah, no problem with it.
With prospects of friendship barred by apathy, fear, prejudice and high walls, what interaction takes place when neighbours finally do encounter one another? With families from the township moving into what have historically been white, middle-class and upmarket suburbs, what about prejudice and racism? For Elijah and Valerie, no problems in Bryanston, but when they first moved to the suburbs in 1992, there were some unpleasant encounters.
I used to stay around Douglasdale, but our opposite neighbors, I think they just could not really take it, so they were quite nasty. At the slightest provocation, I mean, even if we have a small party which had no noise, they would call the police and do all sorts of things. There was one instance where, I mean, the lady of that house phoned my wife and said she shouldn't drive past her driveway if she's entering our property. I mean, those kind of things. But if you've grown up in the South African environment where you've experienced worst racism in the past, you're able to absorb some of those minor racial incidences and say, look, they're not worth your time, and you just move on with your life.
I had no problems with them, but their reaction would have been, I don't know if I would have said racist or anything like that, but I mean, I have since discovered very often people live like that around here. You know, they fight over small things like your branches of your tree falling over my things like those. You know, I had those problems with those people, but I wouldn't say particularly that they were racist. I think it probably happens.
Is it perhaps wrong that whenever we have friends here and we're sitting on my patio and my neighbor is quite near and we're laughing out loud and we're having a good time, then you pop your head over the fence and you say, will you shut up? Is that racism or is it just somebody being plain rude?
Racism, well, more like sad to think that there's any racism. But when you go to like places like Midland Mall, which is in Pretoria, I guess there is, in a sense, tension over there. But I haven't personally experienced any racism at all. No.
I think a lot of people have actually gone past that stage, or we would like to believe that people have gone past that stage. I know that my sister in her area, I mean, has had no problems. And I mean, since I've been here, I haven't had any problems. I haven't had strange looks or anything. I think people are beginning to expect and accept the fact that you're going to have mixed communities.
I was born in Orlando East. It's actually one of the oldest townships in Soweto. I think it was founded around the 30s. That's where I was born and that's where I attended schooling. The only gap was when I went to study at the medical school and then worked at Natal Spirit Hospital. But then around 1990, I then came back to Soweto and I've been there. I've been working there for the past now 14 years. I think my services are much more required in Soweto than anywhere else. I understand the culture of the people I'm serving. And at times, if there's a translation, if somebody translates to you as a doctor, you miss some smaller factors, nuances and things like that. So it's easy not to arrive at the correct diagnosis simply because of that kind of cultural differences. If one then also looks at the income of people who are serving in the township, in terms of access to resources, you're dealing with a community that's at the lower end of the social stream. And therefore, even in terms of what you expect them to pay, it's based on what they can afford. Comparatively, our rates are far lower than the rates which are charged in the northern suburbs. And some of the people we're serving are pensioners and they're not working. I mean, there's a saying that you can take a man out of the township, but you can't really take the township out of him. It's one part that becomes a part of you. It's one area where people live a certain way. And the kind of way that they live is the kind of way that, to a large extent, you identify with. In terms of how things are done, in terms of relating to other people. So one still finds that spirit of Ubuntu, I mean, within a township, where you find the community spirit, where you find sharing, caring, and concern from people around you. Even where I work, I'm concerned about the people around where I work, and the whole emotion is reciprocated. One feels that you're being cared for. So there's that bond, I mean, that link, like an umbilical link, that really continuously keeps you attached. I mean, even in my dreams, I dream of myself being in the township, so it's really embedded within me. I've had colleagues who've tried to move into previously white areas, which are now slightly mixed, and none has had a viable practice. I mean, they had to lock and go. So I think, I mean, the reality of the South African situation is that we've had racism for more than 50, 60 years. It's something that's embedded in people's psyche. I mean, in that if they move in and they find a black practitioner, even the kind of questioning that you'd get would then show that they don't have much confidence.
With Elijah on his way to work in Soweto, Valerie too sets off, taking Cindy and Bushla to school. Like many mums in the suburbs, it's the start of a long day's driving. A day spent in the car, seeing to the school and extramural needs of the children. For Valerie, it's a world far removed from the one she grew up in the township of Dobsonville in Soweto.
I don't know most of my neighbours around here, you know, and if there's anyone who has children the age of my children, who could probably be friends to them. I don't know anyone. I drive in and out. You hardly see anyone walking except if they are jogging or walking in the morning as part of their exercise. But probably walking to the shop, who not in this area. So it's very different. The lifestyle is different even for the children. They go to school, they come back, and that's all they can do. If you have to play, you have to arrange, make appointments in advance. Being in a predominantly white school, they make friends with white children, you know. But they look at children as other children, you know, and I suppose that's the way it has to be, you know. People are people irrespective of where they come from, how they look, you know. So they make friends with anyone, you know, whoever they get themselves involved with, whoever is in their classes. They notice that they are different, you know, that they're black and the other children are white, and I mean that the races are mixed. But they understand. It doesn't bother them as such, and I think they actually get irritated with, you know, racial things, because they always say, I mean, what's the big deal? People are people.
Now we've got families that we closer to, white families, where our kids are attending the same school, and one of the families, Valerie, has a lift club with Kim, one of the white ladies, and they would take kids to school and one would fetch them that way. And last year, I mean, when we went for a holiday, I think around the south coast in Durban, I only realized when I was there that there were three other families who were there, where our association is through the kids. So we're four families, three white and our family. But like, we get along quite well. Yay!
As with most households in the suburbs, Valerie has full-time domestic help. For Ruth Gumbi, originally from the Nelspruit area of rural Mpumalanga, Bryanston is a long way from home. This is her first experience working for a black family in Johannesburg's northern suburbs. After 5 years in the area, Ruth has also not made too many new friends in Bryanston. For Valerie, keeping a watchful eye over her children's play arrangements, the environment of jacuzzi, swimming pool, trampoline and tennis court is very different from that experienced by her as a child.
The street I stayed in, it must be like probably 20 houses. But from the corner, and my house is right at the end. And I would go passing people and greeting them all the time. It was just a lovely environment. No, and playing in the street, it actually felt safe just being there. My parents having gone to work, there was no babysitter, no helper in the house, just myself and my sister. But there was always a mother around us, you know, whether from the other house or, you know, like, so in the townships and Soweto particularly, I mean, every mom is your mom. So it was actually nice. All children were my friends.
From modest beginnings, this is the home in Dobsonville, Soweto, where Valerie was born and grew up. Bringing the children to see their grandparents, Valerie visits regularly, and on weekends, the children often stay over. Back in the township, spending time with their cousins, influences of their upbringing in the suburbs often become apparent.
Such that my children are very different from my cousins or my nephews. And they like, there's this little fear of going to the street because they hardly ever go to the street. And houses in the township are so small, the street is just there. You really don't have a choice. Sometimes there isn't enough space to play, you know, and they go across to the streets. And me as a mother also worries about them. You know, my children are not streetwise. You know, they might be bumped by cars or things like that. So it's really different. I think they're being molded to be themselves. I think I cannot change what they are going through now. I would like them to be exposed to the township, to the way other people grow up. But I don't think it's bad for them to be in this environment and being influenced in whatever way. I don't think it's wrong. I don't know, it's probably just me, but I think we grew up in a different environment and they are growing up in a different environment. I don't think there's a wrong and right in both of them. And I have no problem with what they are being exposed to.
With Linda safely transported to school, Brian continues on his way to work. From the serene environment of the suburbs to the high-powered corporate world of commerce and industry, what, if anything, does Brian Mdluli miss about Soweto and life in the townships?
The simplicity. You know, the waking up, standing at your gate and stretch and say hi to the neighbor. And, you know, just that sense of community. And here where I am now, 3-4 days can go by without me even seeing my neighbor as close as he is, you know. But in Soweto, people used to build gates in between the houses. I miss just the closeness of the community. Soweto will always be a part of my life. Soweto, to a great extent, is what molded me and to where I am right now. There's a lot of things that I do in life, even after I've moved out of Soweto from 1988, I still do because it's what I learned in Soweto. The sense that you can have somebody as a brother who is not born of your mother, and that's how I do business on a day-to-day basis as well. I go to Soweto every weekend. It's almost like a religion for me. You know, as people wake up every Sunday to go to wherever they go, I go to Soweto. I recharge my batteries in Soweto. I get grounded when I'm in Soweto. I'm at home. I really am at home. I'm back at home.
For Brian, if it's Saturday in Soweto, it must be the rock. Club by night and informal rendezvous by day. With Linda and Lindy spending the day with his parents down the road, Brian catches up on the week's activities with long-lost friends. A catalyst to this interaction is the renowned car wash.
I don't think the car wash is per se the reason why we go. It's that you go and park your cars with your friends, they get washed, and you get to sit around with friends and talk about nothing, really, you know. First of all, it will start very seriously and say, how was your week like? No, oh, man, I missed a deal here. Didn't this quite work? Well, I should have tried it like that. But somewhere after two drinks, then it starts becoming like a conversation that comes out of nowhere, where you say, oh, you remember 1982, we used to sit on that rock. Remember what we used to do? Hey, where's that old girlfriend of yours? And all those kind of things. It's a place where after a long, stressed out week, you can go and sit with friends. No, not colleagues, and you sit with friends, people that you grew up with. I always like to call it barometers. You know, people that I grew up with, and we sort of link each other. And the nice part about it is we tell each other, oh, you've done well. Hey, my brother, you know what, you need to do this, to do that, in order to bring yourself up. And those are the kind of friends that I keep around me, the people that see value in what I do, and I see value in what they do as well. And that what takes me to Soweto, the kind of camaraderie, the kind of community, and the sense of sit down and have a good, clean, honest fun with friends.
From the buzz of the rock and the car wash, it's on to Vilakazi Street and Zakumzi's restaurant, strategically situated in the heart of the tourist trade to Soweto. In the neighborhood of two Nobel Peace Prize recipients, Sakumzi's is next door to the house of Archbishop Desmond Tutu, and down the road from the Soweto home of Nelson Mandela, now a museum.
And as soon as you sit down, it's like he's there. They bring you a drink, you deliver an order, you see people that you know, people that know you. And it's such a warm atmosphere. And Saki, the owner of Sakumzi's restaurant, is always there. And he's the kind of guy that makes you feel special. Even if you're coming to have one drink, it makes you feel like a million rand, and you leave there and you've had fun.
From Sakumzi's, it's time for Brian to pass by the family supermarket in Mafolo South, where wife Lindy and son Linda are spending time with his mother. Although he does have friends in the neighborhood of his grandparents' home, this environment, the family shop, is the essence of the Soweto with which Linda is most familiar.
Soweto for him is like a visit. Linda has never, he was born out of Soweto, he's never lived in Soweto, so to speak, you know. So he doesn't have the kind of attachment that I have with Soweto. His attachment to Soweto is that his dad comes from there, and his grandparents, both maternal and paternal, are from there, and he goes to see them. I doubt if he's got that kind of call it sentimental feel I have about Soweto. For him, it's a place where he gets spoiled.
Every kid pretty much enjoys like growing up in Soweto. I mean, you never get bored at all, you know. There's just so much to do. It's a very like vibrant place where a lot is happening, where interaction occurs a lot amongst people. Yeah. And the sense, just that feeling of excitement in the township, you know. A lot of things happening in the township. Not having to like rely, like just wait for a weekend before you go out and go out to parties or to the mall and whatnot. You can just go out into the street and get along with each other.
But there was a dark side. Township schools with apartheid-designed Bantu education. In the late 1970s, private schools in the suburbs began opening their doors to a limited number of black pupils. In the early 90s, so-called Model C schools followed suit for those who could afford it and qualify academically.
In the early days where there wasn't the northern suburbs to take children to, our parents took us to school in Swaziland because they wanted us to have a better education. because my father always believed that the best you can do for a child is give them education, and with the education they would then build a life for themselves. And I suppose it was a conscious decision for me. I wanted him to get quality education. It wasn't about not being a township kid, because I still wanted him to socialize with children his age in the area that he lived in. But in addition, I wanted him to have an education that would give him a better foundation. And because I could afford it, I thought it was in my best interest and in his as well.
I don't think it was a problem for me personally, but perhaps the people who didn't like go to so-called Model C schools thought that you were somewhat a snob, I guess.
In the 80s, it had actually become a norm, because it actually started in the 70s, in the late 70s. So by the mid to late 80s, you'd find a lot of kids in taxis in the mornings being, you know, carted off to school, wherever. So it didn't create any bad feelings. It was expected that parents who could would try and get their children a slightly better education.
Linda went to a daycare center when he was 8 weeks old. We were young parents with Lindy. She had just started work. I was building up my career at that time. So we took him to a day nursery in Sandton. So his entire life has been around, call it, white people and people that speak the English language. I want to speak more and more Zulu to him. But I'm not going to force that. Look, there's absolutely nothing wrong with that. He knows his roots. He knows he's a Zulu boy. He knows he's a black child. English is just our communication. It's not our culture. It's just our language which we communicate together. There is no race or anything like that. A friend of his, Kyle, is white, but that so what? You know, he's no different to me. And he's growing up saying, you know what, we're South African. There isn't a burden of me and you and them and all those kind of things, which happened even in my generation, as young as I am.
For them, they don't see color. I think our lot, we still socialize with people outside of our color groups, but subconsciously we still see color, and they don't.
I mean, there is like various interaction amongst the races, but it's just a thing that people just tend to do, to just hang around their own people. I mean, it's got nothing to do with the racism. You just prefer to hang around your own cause, you just get along with each other.
Sibongile's late father was an Anglican priest who for many years tended the parish at St. Paul's in White City, Soweto. On Sundays, Sibongile often travels back to Soweto to attend service at St. Paul's. More frequently, however, since moving to the suburbs, on Sunday she can be found here at St. George's Cathedral in Parktown.
Actually, the reason why I moved to St. George's was from the first time that I went there. People wanted to know who I was, and I actually felt like I was welcome. And I go to St. Paul's because I still enjoy the manner in which the worship is conducted. The singing there is different. St. George's is very structured. It seems that everything happens in time and to a pace, and you know, you follow a format strictly. You almost feel like you have to hold back because, you know, you have to worship properly. Whereas at St. Paul's, you actually don't have to do that. In terms of my history or my connection with St. Paul's, it goes back to the early 60s when my dad was a minister. He was a rector in that parish. And so even when I moved to when I lived in Pimville, and there was a church, an Anglican church in Pimville, I still traveled from Pimville to White City because I had this pull towards St. Paul's. So there's a very mixed group of people at St. Paul's. And most of the people are people who've had a long history with the parish, and they just keep coming back.
Whenever in Soweto, attending service at St. Paul's, Sibongile takes the opportunity to visit her mother's grave in Avalon Cemetery with family and friends. It's an important family ritual that will ensure Sibongile's regular return to the township in which she grew up.
I visited her grave. She was buried at Avalon Cemetery. And so from time to time, we would go and put flowers on a grave and just clean it up and make sure that it looks okay. But also with the children, the visiting graves has always been, it's something that we do. So from if we haven't been for a while, they'll say, when are we going to Granny? And that will always take us back, yeah.
Whenever we get time to go, especially on a birthday, which is on the September the 5th, I think, yeah, we like to go back to the grave and just like clean up the tombstone, put some flowers around there, just clean the area around there. Yeah.
From the cemetery, it's time for Sibongile and family to catch up with old friends still resident in Soweto, like Mapaseka Lakaba, who lives in the township of Dube. It's on occasions like this, reminiscing about days gone by, that Sibongile really misses those wonderful moments, unique to the township lifestyle she experienced while living in Soweto.
The vibe. I mean, I'd drive into my street and there'd be kids at the corner playing ball or just strolling about. Just having a neighborhood where you could leave and go away, and where you could tell your next door neighbor that you're not at home, and where you know that you would come back and everything would be there. And where if you had a problem at all of any kind, if there was a child who was sick or you needed anything, you could go very close to a neighbor and you would get help, and very readily so. Yeah, that I miss. That I miss. Here you actually almost feel like it's you, yourself and you.
Paradoxically, the Soweto that was born into misery out of apartheid ideology has today become a triumphant icon and celebration of the struggle and ultimate victory by a people against that very oppression. Its origins lie in the establishment of a black settlement at Cliptown on the 12th of October 1904. In 1931, this was followed by the forced relocation of black families out of white Johannesburg to Orlando East. The Nationalist Party government consolidated this relocation process designed to provide a pool of exploitable black labor for the city of gold. By 1963, the process was complete, and the resulting gray expanse of faceless houses known as Southwestern Townships was officially dubbed Soweto. June 16, 1976 was a long time coming. For the children of Soweto, protesting Bantu education and Afrikaans as the medium of instruction, it began as any other day. By nightfall, their actions had changed the course of history in South Africa and emblazoned indelibly Soweto as an icon of the struggle against apartheid on the consciousness of the world. The conflict spread to other townships and some 700 people lost their lives, some 400 killed by police action in Soweto. From that day on, township youth remained at the cutting edge of the internal struggle. The final resting place of many giants of the struggle against apartheid, Heroes Acre at Avalon Cemetery, commemorates all who fell in the struggle against apartheid. And not least, the ordinary men and women of Soweto, who suffered and gave their lives to achieve democracy and freedom for all in South Africa. Whenever possible, Sibongile Mazibuko spends time with family, here at the home of her sister and brother-in-law, Pam and Ben Mgulwa. Musa is also very close to his younger cousins, who, like him, are part of a new generation. A generation born into a very different post-apartheid South Africa.
Their appreciation of what has happened to South Africa as a country and where the country has come from is different from ours. And they almost, I think, feel as if we make a big fuss of nothing. Whereas I think for our generation, there's still very strong sentiments about what has happened in the past. And I find that when I speak to him, sometimes he almost has this attitude of, "Mom, go get a life. We've gone past that. What's wrong with you?"
Well, what can you say? I mean, really, I mean, it's okay if she just brings it up every now and then just to keep me on track. I mean, to make sure that I know what opportunities that I have, which she didn't exactly have. But I don't really like her to dwell on them, you know, because I can't really, in a sense, really relate to the struggle, because the times are totally different.
I do take them to the township quite often. So through that, they are able to get a feel of the area in which we grew up, how we grew up. I do relate to them, even though I know they get bored and say, "Daddy, I mean, we've heard that before." And so I've talked to them about the 1976 and the Sharpeville shooting and some of those historic things so that they should understand where our society is coming from. And they should also understand why Soweto is the way it is and the suburbs are the way they are, and why there's that disparity.
Every 2 months, Elijah's entire extended family meet. Today, it's at the home Elijah bought for his mother in Pimville. There's a set agenda and minutes are taken. Every family makes a regular contribution to the emergency fund. It's an opportunity to share ideas, get family support where needed, and for the children to revisit the township.
Yes, it's very important. It's very important because my roots are there, you know. And for them to be able to learn about it means them going there all the time. They thoroughly enjoy going. They love it. It's also important for them to know their history, to know where they come from, you know. I think it's important for everyone, not necessarily just for them.
Well, yes, obviously, it's, my roots have to be in Soweto. I mean, I can't just really, like, go and deny it. I mean, I spent basically, like, my whole childhood in Soweto, so basically gets my ties up with Soweto. Yeah.
One of his many achievements, Dr. Elijah Nkosi, is chairman of the board of Chris Harney Baragwanath Hospital. Like many other Sowetans, it's been a long, difficult road for the young boy, one of nine siblings, who spent his weekends at Orlando Stadium selling oranges and apples and shining shoes to raise the funds necessary to get himself to medical school.
I'm extremely proud. I mean, Soweto has, in actual fact, produced quite a number of people who've excelled, who, despite the adverse events of the time, were able to struggle through the obstacles, and they've been a beacon of hope for quite a number of people in the township. In terms of role modeling, people who could be acting that role have moved out of the township. And the role models are gangsters. And I mean, in that they would drive flashy cars and do all sorts of things. As kids grow up, they see these people who don't even have an education but are living quite a lavish lifestyle. And now if they then have to study and then work hard to be able to achieve something, they feel it's a bother. I mean, if it could be done differently. So it's critical that people who come from the township still maintain contact with the township.
There's a great importance for people to give back to Soweto what they took out. I do it. I got two guys, Sam and Bafana, who I'm paying for their studies. Sam, I'm helping him finish his matric, and Bafana, I'm helping him through a call center course. It's not a lot of money, but it's money that I would have used somewhere, and I've decided that I want to do it and give something back to them.
My belief is that I haven't changed. I'm still what I was. 20 years ago. What has changed, it's how I do things now. I'm doing things differently. Because as you grow up, you pick up certain values, you pick up certain lifestyle, you pick up quite a number of things that influence your behavior and the way you do things. But the you, the self that you are, I don't think it should change.
A person is what's in your heart, you know, that you as a person, how you treat other people, how you interact with other people, that is you. What you have is just what you have. You never know what will happen tomorrow. You might not have anything, you might have more, but I think people don't have to change because of that, and I certainly haven't.
I've got friends who don't aspire to go come and stay in the suburbs, and they get minimal wage or something like that, and they're comfortable where they are. And I'm also comfortable visiting them, and they also are quite comfortable visiting me. So you then keep those kind of friends. But where you feel there's a bit of tension, I mean, it simply means that you've got to move on.
I think it depends on how fortunate you have been in terms of being able to study and being able to earn a decent living. Many people couldn't. I think everyone wishes to have had probably a career and enough earning potential to be able to buy a decent house and take your children to decent schools, you know. So one can only thank God.
Sometimes I think I had an unfair advantage because, you know, I had the education that was slightly different from a lot of my peers. And, I suppose with South Africa having changed and, you know, in the employment arena, finding that you have more opportunities open, I suppose one can't discount that. Therefore, I think it's actually both the fact that I've got, you know, whatever background that I came from, but as well as that, I think the changes in the country have actually helped get me to, you know, where I am, and I suppose we'll continue to do that.
Yes, there are a lot more opportunities for me as a young black guy. Yes, there are. Has it helped me get to where I am now? No. Where I am now, I did it on my own.
Yes, I would love to move in Sandton, not in Sandton actually, specifically, but in any suburb area. And I think I might be able to move maybe in 2 or 3 years' time, yeah, because I don't have enough income to do that. And also that, you know, I have to support my mother and, you know, my sisters. So right now I'm not thinking of moving out as yet. Don't have a problem with that. It's just waiting for that day or that year. Yeah.
A serious banana, 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 a serious banana,